Welcome to Peninsula Seniors Out and About. Today we're at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance for one of their celebrity lectures. Let's go see what Cindy has for us today.
Welcome everyone to the Western Museum of Flight. I'm Cindy Maka, the director. For many years, the job of the test pilot required just two things: exceptional skill with a stick and throttle, and a great deal of courage. But in the age of modern test and development programs, the job of the test pilot is far more complex and requires much more than courage and flying skill. These are necessary, of course, but that is just the start of the list. Today's test pilots serve as an integral part of the engineering development team, fully participating in the process of evaluating the results of existing design decisions and in the process of integrating their own observations in flight with telemetry and other data gathered by expert analysis on the ground. In short, today's test pilot must possess superb flying skills, must also be a thoroughly educated and experienced engineer as well. The Western Museum of Flight is very fortunate today to have two such exceptional individuals on hand and will help us laymen gain a better understanding into the complex, exciting world of testing aircraft. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is our privilege to have with us today Paul Metz and Jim Sandberg.
Well, thanks, Cindy, and thanks to the crew that brought all this together out here. It really is fabulous work. In 1990, I could never have dreamed of 25 years later coming back to see some faces that were very near and dear and remain that way to me. There are some consummate engineers in this audience right here who brought this airplane to life. Jim and I had the extreme pleasure of having the best seat in the house, but we never forgot who put us there. So let's see a show of hands. How many of you worked on the F-23 program in some form or fashion? Fantastic, and my thanks to all of you and those who aren't here for what you did. And what I want to do and what Jim wants to do is give you some idea of what we did back then and what was so revolutionary, truly revolutionary, about what we did and what we were able to pull off. What I'm going to do is have the talk in three pieces. First, I'm going to take us back to the beginnings of the program. And you'll be surprised how early this concept started. I'll tell you the background. I'll tell you why it was important to build this airplane or this class of airplanes. And then we'll go into the test program and the people who helped make that happen. Jim will cover that portion of the program. And then I'll come back up and finish up with the conclusions on it. And we'll invite your questions. We'd like to hold them till the end. But we look forward to your questions and particularly your insights, because much has been lost historically from this program. So some of it is in your heads right here, and we hope to tap into that today and learn more ourselves. It was a quarter of a century ago, and yet as I look at this picture and as I look at the airplane, I'm still struck by how futuristic the airplane looks. It was quite a different shape then. It still is now. The interesting thing is, though, that it was almost a half a century ago that the germ of the idea for this airplane began, 44 years to be more precise. But it was 1971, and the U.S. Air Force began thinking about the next generation of fighters. It's curious to look at the time frame, 1971. The Congress of the United States had granted funding for three brand new fighter aircraft for the Navy and the Air Force. Three fighter aircraft that hadn't even flown yet. And yet here's a bunch of people thinking, well, let's talk about our next toy. And you can only imagine what would happen if the Congress had learned that they were out there trying to come up with something better than the airplanes that they didn't even have in their hands yet. How greedy can you get? So the question is, what was the Air Force thinking? And why were they thinking it? So that's what I want to show you. If you take the 100-year sweep of aviation and combat aviation, 1915 to 2015, you see some interesting parallels. At the beginnings in World War I, the airplane was a weapon, and the weapon of choice was a machine gun, and the machine gun is mounted pointing forward. And for every weapon of war, there's a counter to the weapon of war. And the counter to the weapon of war was a gun on the ground shooting the airplane in the air, which was shooting its machine gun. And initially, it was just nothing more than a piece of artillery that was mounted on a swivel, and you try to hit the airplane with the rifle caliber or cannon caliber guns on the ground. But there was a break or an introduction of something new right after the Korean War, and that is, instead of bullets, they began to put missiles on airplanes. Missiles are much faster, they're more maneuverable, and they have longer range than a bullet. And of course, for every weapon, there's a counter to the weapon, and it turned out to be a missile that would go up and get the airplane and take it down. But the real key to the difference here is that the first picture with the World War I fighter, you're looking at what's called ballistics. You shoot the gun, the bullet leaves, and once the bullet leaves the muzzle of the gun, it's gravity and aerodynamics that determine where that bullet goes. And if the target moves ever so slightly from the time you fire the bullet, it misses. The bullet will miss. The difference here with these weapons after the Korean War was that you fire the missile and a radar looks at the airplane no matter what it does and guides the missile. The missile can redirect itself in flight to chase down the airplane. So you can refer to this advance in air combat as creating bullets with a brain. And let me give you an example. This is a missile system from the Vietnam War. It's called a SA-2. A Soviet doctrine was to fire two missiles for every airplane that they wanted to hit. They fire them 600 apart. The missile has a big booster, shoves it up, and then the sustainer rocket takes over. You can see the contrail beginning here as the missile climbs up and away. This actually happens to be a test shot, and you'll see up top a parachute with an object on it. It'll show up here in just a minute. There it is, right here. And this is the target, right here. So the radar is directing that missile, and look how it can move so rapidly, change direction, and bam, it hits it. Now the pieces are starting to fall down, but there's a piece that falls down right about here. There it is. This missile is being directed by the radar. It's going to take care of all the pieces. So you can kind of imagine what that's like from a pilot's point of view in the airplane. That really is a bullet with a brain in it, and there's very little you can do to outsmart it. This is a picture taken 3 seconds later. 3 seconds before this, this airplane, this F-105 here, was right here. And at this point, a surface-to-air missile came in from the left side and exploded. And when they explode, it's like a shotgun. There are thousands of steel pellets that come out, and it hit that F-105, and then 3 seconds later, you see it on fire and going down. This became a major loss creator for our aircraft in Vietnam, and we had to do something about it. This is what the system looked like. It was the missile on the ground that you just saw. It was a special radar that could track very precisely the airplane in flight, which you also saw it tracking. And that radar could control the missile. So the solution back then was, okay, cut the link between the missile and the radar. And the way we did that was three things. We used chaff or window that was used in World War II initially, but we used that in Vietnam. That creates noise on the radar scope of the radar operator, and he can't see the airplane for all the noise. We used jammers, special pods that could actually interfere with and destroy the signal of that radar on the ground, again cutting the link. And then third, we would just get low altitude to where the radar simply can't see you because there's mountains and dirt in between you. All of those things have negatives about them. For example, train masking, you're so low and going so fast that it's hard to see any target, and you're gobbling up fuel at a great rate. But that's all we had at hand in 1972. And it was getting a lot worse. In the upper left side, you see the Soviet airborne warning and control airplane. When introduced, this allowed this airplane to get up at high altitudes and look out at very long distances and look down against the ground and find our airplanes. Once they found the airplanes, then they could direct the fighters, and you see in the upper right and the lower left, the Fulcrum and Flanker aircraft, the Soviets' newest aircraft at that time, very maneuverable airplanes, but the real key to these airplanes was they had radars that could also look to the dirt, and they had missiles that could go down into the dirt and find us even though we were down at very low altitudes. So suddenly the sanctuaries that we had in 1972 were disappearing, and the Soviets were putting out the next generations of these surface-to-air missiles that were now faster, more lethal, and were less or more resistant to our jamming and attempts to cut that link between the missile and the radar, and the missile and the radar. So we had to come up with something new, because this was keeping us from using our F-15s and F-16s and F-18s in highly defended areas. We just could not get through the defenses. So the government spent 10 years looking at ideas. That's what happened in 1971 to 1981. It was only 10 years later, in 81, that they asked us, the contractors, to come in and give us our ideas of how to work this problem, this thorny problem. 9 companies were offered the chance to get involved. 7 companies took the government up on the offer. And they gave out a bunch of designs. You see those here on the left side. They're divided into air-to-air solutions and air-to-ground solutions. They also are all over the map in terms of size and weight and capabilities. The Lockheed airplanes down here in the right corners should remind you of an SR-71. They're based on that huge airplane, huge, 115 feet. This airplane, I think, is about 63 feet, and theirs was 115 feet long. So they were monstrous things. Northrop's up there in the upper left-hand side, small airplanes, kind of our heritage. But interestingly enough, nobody at this point in time had thought about stealth. These were tended to be non-stealthy airplanes. On the right side of the picture, the 3 airplanes you see are parts of the evolution of Northrop's airplane, which eventually became the YF-23. And you can see there's a lot of things that were explored. The one in the middle is aptly called the Christmas tree. Well, how much did we know about stealth? Actually, we knew almost as much as Wonder Woman did. She recognized that it was invisible, if it was invisible, it was going to be difficult to see. Okay, that makes sense. But she also realized, quite intuitive, that somebody would pay a pretty penny for the ability to have an invisible airplane. And they were right, because it was going to be expensive. We were treading new areas here. Stealth itself is a concept. What is that? That is the ability to create an airplane that's invisible, in simple terms. Not truly invisible, but so tiny that it's hard to see, hard to pick up with these radar systems we're talking about. These concepts were explored in World War II. The Germans built this airplane, the Horton 229, twin jet fighter. It turned out that it was a subsonic airplane, but very maneuverable. They did fly the first vehicle in December of 44. They had the first production airplane finished, ready to go out to do the test flights when the American forces took over the airfield in April of 45. So it came close to being operational. It turns out it was very stealthy for the radars of its time. Even the skins of this airplane were made out of crushed carbon and plywood to absorb radar energy. So they were well into the concept of making airplanes invisible. We call that Generation Zero. Generation One is represented by the SR-71. You see an airplane that is very fast. This is Mach 3 kind of range we're talking about. Pretty much goes straight and level. It's not a maneuvering platform, and it carries a limited amount of payload internally, cameras in this case, but it can go long distances. Turns out that this airplane was shot at many, many times by those surface-to-air missiles we saw earlier, and never once did they come close to taking it down. And it's not that stealthy. What it does have going for it is speed. And speed, if you're a skeet shooter, you know the faster the skeet goes, the harder it is to hit. And so you're going Mach 3, these missiles can't catch you. And it was part of its survivability. one reason why we also wanted to adapt that characteristic for a fighter. The second generation starts to look not like airplanes, but frying pans flying in formation. These are called faceted designs. Notice every piece of this is a flat plate of some kind welded together in a shape that somewhat resembles an airplane. High subsonic, again, not fighter maneuverability. It didn't have the capability of being a fighter, but medium maneuverability. It carried the payload internal, again, because if you carry a payload external, it destroys your radar signature. And it had limited range. The airplane could be air refueled, but by itself, it didn't have that greater range. Generation 3, Northrop gets into the picture, the B-2 bomber. And this is near the end of the 70s. High subsonic again, pretty much straight and level again. Huge payload by comparison with the other airplanes, and long ranges. So if you're keeping a scorecard, the scorecard looks like this. We determined that the next fighter that we built had to be stealthy, invisible, if you will. It had to be able to go long range on supersonic speeds to help defeat those SAM missiles. And it had to be highly maneuverability because it was going to be an air-to-air fighter against other fighter aircraft. And you'll notice that if you read across there on each one of the generations, we never got there. You and I and the rest of the folks who were on this program were asked to do is create something that never existed. An airplane, a true fighter, that had all of those characteristics together. That was revolutionary and is going to be a watershed mark in the design of airplanes. It's the introduction of stealth technology to fighters. So the challenge was we had to be invisible and omniscient. And let me just give you an analogy what that means. You know about the patrol cop that wants to go out and catch you speeding. He takes the car, he parks it behind a bridge abutment, behind a bush somewhere, so that he becomes invisible, okay? Next, he takes out a radar gun and he points it at you and it's going to catch your speed and then give you a ticket, right? But his failure occurs in the omniscient phase, the all-knowing phase. That radar gun puts out energy and you buy a fuzz buster, and you see him looking at you, and he gives himself away. So it was important for this class of airplanes to not only be invisible, but they had to reach out and touch someone, and you never knew they were there. So that was our challenge. It had to be highly maneuverable, I've already mentioned that, long-range supersonic, and the large internal payload for the missiles. So those are the requirements that we work to. The program that we were on was called Demonstration and Validation, or DEMVAL. And what was unique about it was that we were not constrained to the 1986 technology. In fact, the 1986 technologies would not have gotten us to what I just showed you. We could not have been omniscient, for example, in 1986. So we were asked to stretch the technology and think about it and demonstrate pieces of it that would represent what was probable in the year 2005. We defined, the contractors defined, Lockheed team and the Northrop team, we defined what the ATF was. We didn't have specifications, big, long specifications. We were able to run the test program to test what our portion of the air, or our airplane technologies did. The programs were not the same between the F-22 and the YF-23. And interestingly, we were asked to cough up money, and we, Northrop and our suppliers, copped up one half the cost of this program. And the U.S. Air Force did a great job of leading it. They had the concept of letting us, the contractors, try it out and experiment. And the result was, and quite unusual historically, both the YF-22 and the YF-23 were successful designs and filled the mission requirements. So here's some little known facts that many of you may not know. There initially was not going to be that airplane. Just up until about 3 months before the proposal was to be put in, we got a change from the government, said build prototypes. So we scrambled to do that. And interestingly enough, there were really no requirements. You had to fly one time. I'm not even sure they specified you had to land successfully. there were no specific requirements. It was not a fly-off, as many people suspect it was. It was not because the programs were totally handled independently. The testing was done independently, so there was, you can't make an apples to apples comparison between the YF-22 and the YF-23. They were quite unique. And we were way beyond the state of the art, and particularly the avionics. I think that the avionics is probably the key to this airplane, not so much the airframe you see out there, but we were working way out on the edge of computer technology in that time, in the time frame. And $1.1 billion is what we coughed up. A lot of money that did not, unfortunately, see fruition. I want to transition now a little bit into the test program and give you an idea of what we did. The program was highly classified, up to top secret and beyond. And unfortunately, even the flight reports were classified. So today, I don't have access to even what we did as far as the details go. And much of the classified has been destroyed. So pardon us if we make mistakes, let us know, but some of this comes from our memories and precious little information remains. One of the things that happened right away was people said, you can't show the airplane to anybody. This is before we had to roll out, we had the airplane at Edwards. They said, you can't let anybody see that airplane. But we had to take the airplane out and go down and run the engines and do fuel checks and other things away from our hangar, so we had to move the airplane. And we said, well, how are we gonna do that? And we got these spy satellites flying over the top of Edwards Air Force Base. You don't want us to show the airplane. How do we do that? Some brilliant engineer back at the SPO said, well, look, when we have you transport classified information, it has to be double wrapped. You wrap it once and you wrap it twice, and that way you hide the classified information and nobody can see it. So you double wrap the airplane. Okay, so this was a solution. Now, nobody thought about the fact that the wind blows a minimum of 30 miles an hour at Edwards Air Force Base. But there was a saying back then, don't get mad, get glad. The glad company was just delighted to see us here. Obviously, this didn't last too long before people saw the lunacy of double wrapping an airplane. Okay, this is PAV 1. This is PAV 2 out here. But you'll find today, if you crawl underneath the airplane, you'll actually see the scoop underneath the airplane. And the guys were kind enough this morning to wrap foam and tape around the edges of it, because there's a very sharp scoop on the bottom of the airplane. And it's open on the ground until you get up to flying speed, and then it closes back up. And we had one of our crew chiefs crawl out of the airplane one day and tape the point of it right in the forehead, and it was a nasty little cut. So we decided, well, we have to be safe. So we'll paint a little red triangle onto that scoop, which you'll see out there. And then I said, well, why don't we put another triangle just to accentuate that this is what you're interested in, is this area here. I don't know, it kind of looked like a black widow spider. So anyway, that only lasted a short while before management thought that that was inappropriate, but it did appear on the cover of Aviation Week right after we did it. Bob Sandusky's not here, but Bob Sandusky ran a small team of people embedded in the B-2 program early on, like before the Air Force came to us and asked us for our opinions. And they were looking at the very same problem. How do you make a fighter out of this technology? And they took the B-2 technologies and the concepts and began experimenting with it, and it resulted in the YF-23, as you see here. And this picture is kind of a testament to the fact of who is my father. And the B-2 was the technology was the father of the YF-23. I'm going to let Jim carry the rest of the test program through, and I'll be back to see you at the end.
Where's Bill Flanagan? We never would have got this picture if it hadn't been for Bill Flanagan, but by God, he fought it every bit of the way. Bill Lowe was in that fighter jet. He was out doing a flight test. I was a safety pilot in the mission control, and realized that had just heard by a rumor that our friends in B-2 land were flying. At that time, they were still very quiet about what they were doing. I happened to know Bill and somehow got in touch with him, and I said, hey, when are you going to land? He says, I can't tell you. And he wouldn't. So we played a guessing game with little secret numbers, and we were calling back and forth, said, well, will it be 10 minutes or 45? I can't tell you, but it's not 10. So when Bill Lowe came back and finished his mission and taxied on back, we said, wow, it looks like there's an opportunity that we might not ever see again. Hi, Ed. Good to see you. And so we had Bill Lowe taxi on out to the Hammerhead by the approach end of the runway and sit out there and wait. He said, how long am I going to have to wait? I said, I don't know, but we'll find out. Sent the photographers out there and got a world-class picture, and it's my very favorite picture of all. I just happened to have the opportunity to have flown both of those beautiful airplanes. So we'll talk back to the YF-23. A lot of unique shape characteristics to it. Some of them are because of the stealth characteristics that Paul talked about. Some of them are because of the aerodynamic characteristics that were required from the requirement to be able to fly very fast, fly very high, fly for a very long period of time, not use afterburners, not use too much fuel. Another thing that is interesting, as you can see on the airplane out there and also in this picture, these tremendously large vertical tails. Well, they're not vertical tails, but the things that are hanging out there, the world's fastest bonanza. In addition to the aerodynamic characteristics that it gives to the airplane itself, the rearward field of view is just absolutely panoramic to the fighter pilot. And that's just exactly what Paul's talking about with the picture window form. Also, the air data system on the airplane was designed to have flush ports. That was unique for a fighter airplane, certainly unique for something that was going supersonic. Our friends in B-2 land had been using flush air data systems before. You might see as you walk around PAV 2 here that we also did have L-head total temperature and dynamic pressure ports, and that was primarily as a backup. We were using that for flight test data in order to validate what the flight controls were using. The sinuous ducts, if you look at this as well, the face of the duct is actually one diameter below and to the side from where the engines are themselves. And that's very important from a stealth standpoint, that there's no radar that's going, beams that are going to get into the duct and into the face of the engine that's rotating, which is a very highly reflective radar reflector, and get back on out. And the exhaust duct, we'll look at it a little bit later. Beautiful planform. You get to see the airplane on the side all the time. Not too many people other than pilots get to see the planform, what it looks like on the top. Big part of the design was an edge form alignment planform. So if you look at the airplane that's leaned up there on the side, you can look at and see the large number of lines that are all aligned together. So that radar, whatever radar reflection that the airplane did do, was restricted into known areas. Part of that reflection gave a distinctive figure on the radar scopes that was reminiscent of a eight-legged insect, such as perhaps a spider. And when you look at the top, you can see the planform. Also here you can see the exhaust system, and you can see it when you look at the airplane out here on the side. The exit of the exhaust, including the afterburner, was well forward of the back end of the structure. So the trough that was back there was specially constructed out of careful materials with some active cooling. It was designed by Allison, I think, to do a tremendous job to allow us to use afterburner without burning off our own tail. So that was unique. And that was one of the things that was a little bit different between the two airplanes, because the Pratt & Whitney and the General Electric engines had different upper flaps in the back. Also, another characteristic is that they look at the size of the vertical tails, if you will, the tails themselves. These are tremendously large. They're larger than an F-5 wing, almost as big as an F-18 wing. And these devices rotate plus or minus 40 degrees. Well, you'll see when you play some of these videos, it really moves around a lot. And they are driven by extremely high fast actuators that operate at very high cycle rates, and driven by computers, digital computers, that are really moving very fast. The end result of that is that in order to provide the airplane stability and control, keep it stable, or respond to the maneuvers that the pilot wants, these tails do not have to move very much because they're very large and they move very fast. This is a picture here when we're taking that tail and laid it down, if you will, to show the relative size. It's almost as big as the wing itself. So that's one of the things that made the airplane tremendously maneuverable and also contributed to its stealthiness, because as the airplane maneuvered, it wasn't waving its wings around a lot. This is a picture of the airplanes that were involved with the flight test program, both from a chase standpoint and the test aircraft, just showing some of the relative size and the evolution from the F-16 to the F-15 to the YF-23 in their shape and the efficiency of their wings. We used a lot of off-the-shelf components in the airplane because they were prototypes. We had to make a lot of inventions. We had to make new things that had never been done before, like the exhaust system on the aft deck, like the intakes, like the bleed air system that was driving and protecting the supersonic shock in the inlets, the flight control system. But we didn't need to invent wheels or pumps or brakes. And so we adapted a lot of stuff that you can see here that came from other programs and other things. Anytime you do that, there's always sometimes a little bit of compromise has to be made. We found during the flight test program that we had to be very careful about the braking of the airplane because we had F-18 wheels and brakes which were not sized for a 50,000 pound airplane, even though we weren't landing at 50,000 pounds. So it was a heavier airplane it was designed for, and we had to take care of that not only from a pilot technique standpoint, but also after most landings, we would plan on parking at the end of the runway, have the crews come out, measure the temperature of the brakes, and be ready to apply cooling air if necessary. Because we had to taxi a long way from the runway back to where we were parked at Edwards. So the flight test sorties program that went on was based on a plan of 2.5 sorties per week for each of the airplanes. And each of the airplanes had a learning curve at the beginning, but they finally did get up on the step and they met those projections. But we didn't come out before and talk too much about the program that it was established and started in 1986. And so out of those Northrop people that are here, how many people can remember that terrible and wonderful bittersweet day in October of 1986? That was the day when we were told that the F-20 program was not selected by the Air Force, and it was the death knell of the Tiger Shark. It was the same day that we were selected for the ATF program contract. What a bittersweet day. But when that program was selected in 1986, it was to run for 4.5 years with a contract award in 1991, and it was a fixed amount of time. Our original plans for test these airplanes was a 350 sortie plan. As time went along and gang aft glee and plans didn't work out and schedules slipped, it got later and later and later to the point where we were only able to fly these airplanes for 3 months and 50 sorties. So that made a lot of difference in the flight test planning and what it was that we were going to do. But the biggest part of the story that we want to make sure, besides the airplane, was all the wonderful people that helped us have the dream of flying these airplanes, and you all had the opportunity to work on something that was really very special. I want to say right now that during the period of time I was on the YF-23, I worked with people that I knew from other industries in our teams. I knew worked with people from other divisions. And then later, Paul and I both worked with those same people in different programs on other programs. YF-23 people that I worked with on the F-20, I saw on the B-2, or I saw later on the Super Hornet at Pax River. And people that I worked with McDonnell Douglas on the YF-23, I was working with on Super Hornet and Pax River. So this teaming that goes together, not only individual teaming, but organizational teaming was important. Paul mentioned the magic that happened in the computer world in order to be able to provide the sensors and the computers that would make that fifth generational leap in capability. A lot of that work was done on the YF-23 avionics prototype program by companies like Westinghouse and TRW. I think Litton was in there a little bit as well. So you see, it's not only individuals working together later on teams, it's organizations as well. This is a picture of the flight test team gathered at Edwards Air Force Base during the rollout of the airplane. These are just the folks that were working in the flight test at Edwards. There's a tremendous amount of other people, as you all know, that supported this activity both here at Hawthorne, El Segundo, the electronics division, and all around the country with our other suppliers. There were five pilots that flew the airplane. Paul and I from Northrop Grumman. Bill Lowe was the McDonnell Douglas pilot. We had two Air Force pilots, Major Ron Johnston and Major Con Thusen. Although this is a silly kind of fisheye view, that's what we thought of the airplane, every one of us. Even the Air Force guys. Paul put together a plan to train the first flight team together. They spent more than a year in preparation for the first flight because the first flight was going to be in January of 1990, and it just slipped until August, the 27th of August. But the number of people that were on the flight test team involved a core of flight test experienced people, and then the large bulk of it was people that came from the design activities that actually designed these systems and made them made it work. So we took the true system matter subject matter experts in each field and worked together to build a team that were able to sit and work in the control room to maintain the test objectives, get the data that we needed, and then also be able to respond to things that might go wrong. It was a tremendous test program. My hat's off to Paul and everybody else that had anything to do with it, because it was a great team effort, so we were able to get that first flight team ready to go. And when that first flight took off, everything went tickety-poo. PAV-1 was a great airplane. It had a minor malfunction with the landing gear indication on the first flight that I think might have cut down the time a little bit. But for the most part, the airplane went very well in its flight. PAV-2, the second airplane, was a little bit later in trail. It flew almost 2 months later on the 26th of October. We also had a flight test team that I helped lead, and we went through similar training. But we borrowed a lot of the expertise of that first flight team from Paul's team and benefited from it greatly. Now, here's a list of some of the names. It goes up. You don't have to know them all, but recognize that it's a combined team. There are Northrop people. There are Mac Air people. There are subcontractor people, in this case, Pratt & Whitney for the PAV-1. And we've got Air Force people, not only in the pilot positions, but also in some of the engineering capacities. The main flight test engineer for both of these PAV airplanes were both McDonnell Douglas contractors, I mean, teammates. So we had Jim Martin for PAV-1, and I had Walcott Blair for PAV-2, and their able assistants right behind them, the guys who were doing all the heavy lifting, was Les Dowd and Mike Hans. So we went on, and it was a combined team of contractors and players, to the point where Paul wants to make sure that everybody understands that the Pratt & Whitney team was critically important to the success of their flight test program on PAV-1. And I got the same thing, but I didn't get a medallion from the General Electric people. So talk a little bit about the statistics that up there. I mentioned that it was planned for 350 flights. We only flew 50. We only flew about 65 hours. I'll get the numbers wrong because I can't see it from here. But shows the total number of flight that we flew, maximum Mach. We went out to 1.8. That was in PAV-1, because it was the flutter airplane that would go out and clear the envelope. I think PAV-2 only went to 1.7 during one of its tests. Maximum altitude, we're pretty much 50,000 feet. It was just a rule in the total number of flights for both of those airplanes. The big difference between the two airplanes, about the only difference other than the instrumentation, was the engines, because this was a competition, although not a fly-off competition, between two airplane designs and also between two engine designs. These were the envelope that we explored as far as we went, when the first flights were. Longest flights, 3.3 hours. Obviously, we had air refueling for those, and we relied a lot on air refueling and the speeds that we went on through angle of attack and side slip. So it was a compressed, very compressed flight test program where we had to tunnel through the envelope in order to get to the points where we wanted to do. We wanted to prove super cruise, so we wanted to get out there to those super cruise positions. We wanted to demonstrate level one flying qualities throughout the envelope, and we had to do the air refueling, etc. But not everything goes great on every flight test program, despite the fact that PAV-1 was a great team of professionals, and they were going off and probably went through flight six before it had anything that untoward. Now, PAV-2 was a little snake bit, and it wasn't because of the team, it was just the way things were. So I'll talk about the first flight that we had. When I did the first flight on this airplane, and my team as well, I thought we were kind of in the rocking chair. Boy, the Lockheed Martin guys had flown the General Electric engine long before on their first flight. Paul had already flown the PAV airplane, the YF-23. We knew that it worked. Everything's pretty good. Well, this is a true first flight because it's the first time together with a new airplane and a new engine together, but we thought everything should be okay. The Air Force required us to go through a long process for a first flight of briefing ahead of time, going out and practicing with surrogate airplanes to practice a first flight, to help the crews practice and help the instrumentation people practice, help the people in the tower practice. I argued a little bit to say, do we really need to do this, particularly taking off on runway 04, which is opposite the normal direct flow of traffic, but said, we have to do it because we have to be safe. We were.
Release brakes.
Paul's the chase airplane in the F-15, just told me to release the brakes. I release the brakes, the airplane's rolling down the runway. I look down the runway, I see a light at the end of the runway. I think there's a truck on the runway. I said, oh, I think there's a truck on the runway. And then the light went out and turned off to the side. I said, well, he's off of the runway now, so we'll keep going. On the other side of the airplane is the F-16. He's the photo chase. I mean, no, the F-16 is the safety chase. Yeah, there was an airplane landing on the runway in the opposite direction, but despite all of the practice, all of the briefing, all of the special procedures which were taken care of to avoid that possibility. And, oh, by the way, the fact that it happened to be our own Roy Martin in a T-38. Lieutenant Colonel Roy Martin on his reserve duty at the test pilot school on an instructional sortie. Well, communications broke down in the tower cabin, but boy, I'll tell you, that could have been a real eye-opener. Well, thanks, Roy. Roy, actually, the thanks is to Roy's student who was in the front seat, and he's coming down and he says, I think there's an airplane on the runway. And Roy says, where? And he looks and says, wow! So when I was a young test pilot, came to work for Northrop, Daryl Cornell, who briefed me on how to... briefed me on how to fly airplanes with their... came right out of the hangar, and he said, when you first take off an airplane for the first time, put the landing gear up, and then put the landing gear down. And when I put the landing gear down, we had that crazy condition there with only the nose gear down. We thought about it for a long time.
Just west of the field. And you're clear.
The only thing we could do was to raise the gear up because we couldn't land with only the nose gear down. Recommend that we leave them down. Our trusty test chase pilot. Thank you, Taco. I agree. That was on the second flight of PAV 2 was when we went up and we did the air refueling test. And did the first time we went to the air refueling, and that's when we recognized a significant, about the only real significant pilot difference between the two airplanes. The General Electric airplanes were very, very powerful, but they were also very, very responsive, but they weren't well coordinated with the throttles, and it was very difficult to do very close maneuvering. And the first time I went to the tanker, because I'd already been to the tanker in Paul's airplane, and I got there and I said, I said, I don't think I'm going to be able to do this. And then finally, I got an inspiration, and I put one throttle at idle and the other one up in high power, and it gave me enough good, fine, linear control to be able to do it. So we left the tanker and said, now we're going to go off and do some real testing. And about that time, I had an engine malfunction that came up, and we had to return to base on the second flight. Declared an emergency. So then on the third flight, Paul's chasing me and we're going off, said, all right, now we're going to go off and do some real testing. Everything's all set. Took off, we climbed on up. We're climbing through about 27,000 feet. I think before that, 18, 19,000 feet might have been the highest we went. And as we pass through 27,000 feet, Paul gives a call and says, you're venting. And about the same time, the control room saying, descend. Don't know what's going on. We'll pull the power back and we descend. And there was a problem with the pressurization equalization in the fuel tank, which had allowed the fuel tank to overpressurize almost to 150% of its design load. And if number one, the vent hadn't been there, but most important, we had sharp people in the instrumentation room that were watching data, and they saw something that they did not understand, didn't know why it was, and they weren't expecting it, but they knew that we had to do something and called us to descend, probably saved the airplane, might have even saved my life. And I thank whoever that was. Thank you very much, Fuels. fourth flight, Paul said, that's enough. I want to fly this airplane. It's about time. Get out of here. You're just causing trouble. He took it flying, and I went to chase him. So I'll go along and chase him as well. And we were out, and we were flying Mach 2, Mach 1.5. Paul was flying it, doing the envelope, going out to the envelope that he had already cleared in PAV 1. And the windscreen cracked. Here you can see a picture, I think, of the windscreen cracked. It had happened previously on PAV 1 at a lower speed, probably around flight 9, something like that. So there was a problem with the design of the windscreen. In fact, there had actually been a windscreen that had cracked in the hangar long before the airplane was put together. So that was a problem that we had to resolve, but we didn't have time to solve it technically. We were able to solve it brute force. Thankfully, there was somebody that supplied sufficient parts so that we were able to replace this and then continue the flight test program. But I guess if we'd had a longer flight test program, we probably would have run out of windscreens. Super Cruise was one of the main things for the program, something that we had to demonstrate. And this is a demonstration here of the way that the airplanes were configured, if you will. The number one YF-22 was powered with the General Electric engine. And the number two Lockheed Martin F-22 was with the Pratt and Whitney engine. That configuration was reversed for us, don't know why, but PAV-1 was equipped with the Pratt and Whitney engine, and PAV-2 was equipped with the General Electric engine. The difference between the speeds for both of those airplanes was dependent only to the engines themselves, and it's interesting to see that when the Air Force made their decision, they selected the airplane on the left, which was the Pratt & Whitney F-22.
Let me make some closing remarks, and I will warn you ahead of time, this is not Northrop speaking, this is Paul Metz speaking, this is my own observations, and you can take them for what they're worth. I have come to learn that in prototyping competitions, like the YF-23, YF-22, there is a tangible and an intangible perception that you leave with your customers. Northrop is, in my opinion, the finest engineering, aircraft engineering company in the world. They very accurately predicted the YF-23 and other airplanes that I was fortunate to test with them. And so the engineering skills are beyond compare. So Northrop sees things in those terms, in other words, engineering terms. Let me show you a graph. Let me show you what the airplane does. They match, therefore you can trust me because I can predict what my product will do. And that's very important, and Northrop is unparalleled in that ability. But there's another aspect to this competition. Not everyone that will look at your airplane or even be in a position to select your airplane will necessarily be an engineer. And they may not be astute technically. So there's another way to leave an impression. Some people say this is the picture that sold the F-16. It is, the F-16 is the airplane flying the inner circle, and the F-4 is the airplane flying the outer circle. So your gut reaction should be, give me that F-16, that thing can turn. But we don't know today what were the conditions of that picture. We don't know if the F-4 was simply flying a constant speed and the F-16 was hauling back and making as tight a turn as he could, but also losing his airspeed in the process. We don't know any of that. But it leaves a lasting impression that you'll remember after you leave this briefing here. So pictures are worth 1,000 words applies in a technical, competitive competition, just like it applies in real life for any other things we do. And Lockheed understood that. And they left impressions. They took their airplane and flew it to 60 degrees angle of attack. You see that here in the left and the upper right. High angles, what's called high angle of attack. It's a very exhilarating thing. It's a meaningful thing to fighter pilots. And they have photographs of 60 degrees angle of attack. Now, it turns out that that airplane right there will do that exact same maneuver and stabilize at that exact same angle of attack. In the lower right side, you see a missile coming off the airplane, fire coming out of the missile, and this is a warplane. We're leaving an impression. reality is that's a very benign shot. It's not a stressing shot for the missile. The missile comes out and flies away quite cleanly. Very benign. In fact, the high-angle attack testing portion was relatively benign. There wasn't anything severe about it. Yet you and I and other people are left with this lasting impression of what that airplane is compared to that airplane. And it becomes part of a decision-making process. So I look back on that and said, I hope we learn our lesson that there's sometimes there's showmanship as well as technical excellence that you have to play that game. I'll wind up here with one comment. Some of you that know what my career was following this and a short stint in the B-2 program. I was hired by Lockheed to make the first flight on the F-22 Raptor. No pilot ever flew both of these airplanes, both of the prototypes. By design, by intent, they never allowed that to happen. So you'll have to keep that in perspective for what I'm about to say next. I've had a number of people come to me over the years, and we've talked about the YF-23 with great fondness, and lamented the fact that we were not picked. And I tell them, like I'll tell you, that never hang your head in shame about what we did. We built a tremendous product that would stand side by side with anything else, and in many cases exceed the capabilities of anything else. And we can always be proud of that. So I thank you very much for your attention, and Jim and I will be happy to answer questions. Question is, how fast can these things go? And the answer is it's a design for Mach 2. The airplanes went out less than that. They had far more capability, we could tell that, but we never tested them to their maximum speed.
The question is, how much did the thrust vectoring equation enter into the decision-making equation? In that the F-22 had thrust vectoring, the F-23 did not have thrust vectoring. That was a conscious design decision by our design team. We talked about the tandem wing. We talked about the tremendous size of that tail. We talked about the 40 degrees of throw that it has driven by high-speed actuators. Thrust vectoring provides some increment of additional pitch control, and pitch control only. That increment of pitch control, compared with the tremendous amount of control power that we had, was not determined to be critical. The results that we got from that we heard from the evaluation of the airplanes leading up to contract award was that the evaluations were based on stoplight usage. It was green, yellow, or red, and that both of these airplanes were fully capable in green. So that the design or the award decision was made by Secretary of the Air Force Rice, and it was made, quite frankly, it must have been made on non-technical issues because the technical results were equal. Both airplanes were qualified.
Yeah, and that was actually the official wording of Secretary Wright's, was that both airplanes met the requirements. They had greater confidence that Lockheed could manage the program. So nothing that we did was detrimental as far as we can tell from the selection process. Yeah, the question is, what role does a simulator play in preparing you to fly something like this? I flew the simulator so many hours I could puke.
The airplane flew just like a simulator, and you say, people always say that. Today they do say that, because the airplanes are designed by the same computer technology that generates the flight control laws, that generates the simulators that you use, that generates the airplane performance. You saw from those graphs the tremendous amount of correlation between actual flight test data and what we were expecting. And what we were expecting is what we flew in the simulator. So every pilot that flew the airplane said, well, yeah, it flew like the simulator. The question is, when we did Super Cruise testing, did we have to use afterburner to punch through the number? This is an interesting question. I did the Super Cruise tests on both engines, both airplanes. We started at 0.85 Mach, 42,000 feet. We went to full military power, and we just continued to watch it go until it cooked out. And it would be amazing to me in my experience that when you got into the transonic area as I was watching the numbers tick off, it was 0.97, 0.98, 0.99, 1.0, 1.101, 1.02. There was no hesitation. I did not have any sense of the transonic rise at all. So that was very impressive. Now, another way of doing the testing, which would be more efficient, was to go to full afterburner and get very fast and then take it from the fast side, go into military and see how it cooks down. We selected to do that test because we got a wealth of PSEBS data from 8.85 Mach all the way on up.
Question is, what followed from this effort into the future? I told somebody a while ago, this is only one third of the program you're looking at. And one other third is the avionics of this airplane. My opinion, the avionics are the most important part of this system. Remember I told you about the omniscient, the ability to see things, but they can't see you? That is an incredible amount of computer sophistication. And so I think that's what carried forth. Northrop had a complete organization for avionics development. And in fact, I've spoken to several folks here that were in that group. And we reached out way out in time. And that type of architecture, technology, the way the computers operate, yes, that has been carried into the future, more so than just the nuts and bolts of the airframe. Okay, well, he's asking how much fun was it, you know? And there's the old adage, which is it's the most fun you can have with your clothes on. You know, it is fun. It's exhilarating, but we're trained to get rid of the emotion. We have switches in our brain that let us turn it off and concentrate exactly on what's going on and let the rest of the world be pushed away. So as bland as it sounds, we're unemotional in the airplane. We concentrate very deeply. So, but it is an extraordinary and rare occasion for a pilot to make a first flight on an airplane.
That said, when we were preparing for the first flight and Paul was going to be flying the airplane for the first flight, I worked with the people who were making up the test cards and made sure that the flight test conductor, there was a point in the flight after he got on up and everything was just a point in between points where the next test point was, look out the window and enjoy.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for watching Peninsula Seniors Out and About here at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance. I'm Betty Wheaton. I'll see you next time.